parties have in neighboring countries. So the history, basically, for the two first post-Soviet decades in Ukraine of the far right was rather exceptional in that it was an underdeveloped, I would say, in comparative perspective, scene that there were a whole number of organizations in Arantsov, like the Social National Party of Ukraine, the Patriot of Ukraine, the Social National Assembly, Bratstvo, or Brotherhood, the Conservative Party, and so on. And these groups existed partly, they allied with each other, they took part in elections, and they never managed to get over the relatively low 3 to 5% barrier into the Verkhovna Rada. There were individuals, of course, that were elected in various elections to the Verkhovna Rada, but that was always too small to create a notable force in a faction in the Supreme Council in the Parliament of Ukraine. And then, indeed, in the late 2000s, then this changes in that one of these minor parties of the 1990s and early 2000s, the so-called Social National Party of Ukraine, makes a transformation, becomes in 2004 the already mentioned All Ukrainian Union Svoboda. And this party then indeed manages to break out of this lunatic fringe scenery and has its breakthrough, as you perhaps, some of you perhaps know, in 2009, in a very peculiar situation in a regional election in Ternopilska Oblast, where Svoboda rather unexpectedly, after much lower results that these parties even got in Galicia, won the elections to the Oblastna Rada with over 30%. And then in the 2010 elections, the Svoboda Party also in local elections then had relatively high results, especially in Galicia and Volhynia, but also, for instance, in Kiev. And then as the comes the already mentioned breakthrough for the Ukrainian far right in 2012, with a result over 5% and much more than 5%, over 10% in the parliamentary elections. And for the first time then, for 2 years, the far right has then a faction in the Verkhovna Rada. Well, the if you, and that now looks as a breakthrough, and what then happens is actually quite surprising, is that you had this peak, and that looks very much in the trend of Eastern Europe, and you could even argue in the whole of Europe, but then you come to 2014, And then again comes a defeat for the far right, both in the presidential elections of May 2014, by the way, on the same day of the European parliamentary elections, so there were some very obvious comparisons, and then especially in the parliamentary elections of October 2014, where Svoboda doesn't manage to get over the 5%, and therefore only manages to get a couple of single member district candidates into the Verkhovna Rada, and then basically this actually restores then the situation from before 2012 in a certain way. And that is a puzzle in a way for a whole number of ways in terms of the generally weak performance of the far right, but also why was there this result and why didn't Ukraine follow the example of other countries in Europe and develop a more sustained, stronger faction in the in the parliament. And the solution to this sort of puzzle is, if you look at the electorate of Svoboda in 2012, there has been a number of researchers studying this. Natalia, I think is her name, Belitzer in Kiev, for instance, or a scholar here at in North America, Arizona State University, Lenka Bustikova. They have looked at on the electorate of this in these elections of Svoboda, and what they found is actually that the electorate was a very untypical one. So the electorate was disproportionately urban, highly educated, and also the voters for Svoboda were pro-European, pro-democratic, rather untypical far-right voters. And that, again, for those of you who have followed this period, had a lot to do with the very specific political situation in 2012, that there was in 2010 the election of Viktor Yanukovych, who then manipulates the political scene, the constitutional order, in order to centralize power in a way following Putin's example, who then also introduces a whole number of new foreign and cultural policies that are perceived as a threat to Ukrainian independence and its European pro-Western orientation. And that was also this peculiar electorate in 2012 was a reaction to the infamous Tushki phenomenon, namely the rather sad practice in Ukrainian parliament, known for many years, but especially salient then in 2010-2011, that deputies elected on the lists of the Orange, as they were then called, parties, Nasha Ukraina and Bakivshina, were switching, were running away from the from their factions and supporting the Azarov government. And then the sort of somewhat rational choice then was for many voters to go to Svoboda, which announced that it would not have any Tushki. Tushki, for those of you who haven't followed this, is an untranslatable word. It actually comes from Russian, and it means the dead body of a chicken. And so I would sort of translate this as a zombie or so. So these were basically deputies that were especially those elected on the lists of the Orange parties, the Yushchenko and Tymoshenko parties, that came on this pro-democratic, pro-Western, national democratic ticket into parliament, but then were basically bought off by the Party of Regions and the Azarov government and betrayed, I would say, their voters. And Svoboda was on this background and announcing that it would not have any Tushki and zombie deputies. And indeed, to my knowledge, never did a Svoboda deputy, after Svoboda then came into parliament in 2012, switch factions. So there was no betrayal of the mandate. And then the peak, so to say, of the political success of Svoboda was its participation in a rather prominent role in the Euromaidan uprising, and especially then its inclusion in the first Yatsenyuk government after the victory of the Euromaidan with initially four ministers. And then one left, and then till October 2014, three ministers. And then, as I mentioned, again, the party is thrown out, basically, of the out of power, as the faction is has to dissolve after the elections, in spite of the active participation of Svoboda in the Euromaidan and the rise of course, natural, I would say, rise of militant patriotism as a result of the ongoing war in eastern Ukraine and the annexation of Crimea. At about the same time, then, the second interesting movement, or initially movement and then party, appears the Pravý sektor, the right sector, that, which you have probably heard, and which has been especially prominent in Kremlin propaganda. There was a period in spring 2014 where a media watchdog reported that over a couple of weeks Ukrainian, I would say, and then still minor party, far-right party, the right sector, was in Russian mass media almost as many times mentioned as the ruling party of Russia, Yedina Rossiya, United Russia. So this was then the, in a way, also you could argue an advertisement for the right sector in Ukraine. Some of you may know that the right sector was initially a small group of circa 200, 300 mainly men, which came together in early December 2013, and which came from different little nationalistic organizations. The already mentioned Unam So, the Ukrainian National Assembly, Ukrainian National Self-Defense, and especially the the minor organization called Prizuk Unionist Anna Bandera. So, and the leader then also of the right sector, Dmitry Yarosh, comes from this organization. This party then, or this initial informal group, then becomes a party in spring 2014. That happens through a renaming, basically, of the Ukrainian National Assembly, an old far-right party from the 1990s. And the party then tries to take part in elections and tries to be successful in elections, as I mentioned already. This is even more disastrous for the right sector than for Svoboda. So the Svoboda candidate for the presidency gets slightly over 1% in the May 2014 presidential elections, whereas the presidential candidate from the right sector, Dmytro Yarosh, does not even get 1% in these elections. And a somewhat similar story then goes for the parliamentary elections in October 2014, where Svoboda gets slightly more than 4%, but does not make the 5% barrier, and the right sector does not even get 2%. What then happens is something very typical for these new far-right parties, or in general, I would say, for new parties. The right sector splits in late 2015, namely its most prominent leader, Dmytro Yarosh, leaves because of personal disagreements with other leaders the movement and creates its own party called Державницька Инициатива Яроша, which also then creates its own volunteer unit, Ukrainska Dobrovolcha Armia, and which is then drawn also from the right sector's volunteer unit, the Dobrovolcha Ukrainska Korpus, the Duk, a volunteer battalion that had been formed in spring and summer 2014. As a result of the covert intervention of Russia in eastern Ukraine, and the rise of this volunteer movement that then also included a number of irregular, semi-regular armed groups that were formed by different far-right groupings. The most famous one of them, and maybe the most interesting grouping to watch of all of these was, is also now a movement, a combination of organizations that came out of such a volunteer battalion of Spring, formed in Spring 2014 in reaction to the war in eastern Ukraine, and that is the, as you probably already heard about, the battalion, or later then Regiment Azov, that was formed in May 2014 out of a very marginal and until then almost unknown, or only to experts known, little grouping of.
You're the one.
Well, there's not much.
Someone else.
There's not much competition, indeed. But even among, I think, until May 2014, I think even many of experts on Ukrainian politics, they wouldn't have known these people who then formed the Azov Battalion, that was a group that was called Patriot Ukraine, or Social National Assembly, that was an older grouping that had formed out of the Social National Party of Ukraine, when Kanyumov transformed this this party of the 1990s in 2004 into a more right-wing populist party on the model partly of the Front National, or the Freedom Party in Austria. There was a little split-off of a few young men who formed then a more radical party that that really belonged to the lunatic fringe and had not much exposure in media, but then had its chance when the war started, and formed relatively quickly one of these new volunteer battalions, and had early on in the war that then gave basically large push to this grouping. An enormous, I would say, an enormously important military success, namely the liberation of Mariupol in summer 2014, which is for which this Azov battalion is credited. And it was not only Azov, but indeed this grouping then played a crucial role in bringing this strategically very important city, Mariupol, back under the control of the EU. And this initial pain then becomes the background then for the emergence of a movement. First, it looks as if Azov mainly stays a military unit, and then it's integrated in the National Guard of the Ministry of Interior of Ukraine, but the original founders of Azov, Andriy Genetsky and others, they were initially politicians, then became soldiers, but then they returned again to politics, and they started to form indeed a movement, a political movement, and that is, I think, something worrisome, that you have a unit of the an armed unit in the forces of the Ministry of Interior that is linked then to a party formed in 2016 called the National Corps, and also to a national militia movement that is then developed that you may have heard about, which is a sort of unarmed which consists of unarmed units that are patrolling in various Ukrainian cities. Whereas Svoboda remained a traditional party, it also was engaged with various volunteer units, but it remained a traditional party. The right sector was haunted by this split of 2015 and has become again a fringe grouping, I would say. The Azov project is a more sustained and more multifarious and so far, I would say, successful project that has that is sort of dynamically developing and that I would say would have to be watched. And maybe in conclusion, before we switch to the question sessions, there is now an attempt by these three groupings, the Svoboda Party, the Azov related National Corps, and the Right Sector to form an alliance. There was in 2017 a congress at which these three parties adopted a memorandum, and the big question will be whether these three parties will be able to form a unified list in the next parliamentary elections. The parties by themselves have currently not enough electoral support to pass the 5% barrier, but if they unify, if they form a unified party, probably that would be on the basis of the of Svoboda, and Svoboda would have to share, so to say, some of the places on its list with representatives from the right sector and the National Corps of Azov. If these three parties unite, then they may indeed have a good chance, I would say, in the next parliamentary elections to get over the 5% barrier, maybe even way over the 5%, and again to form a faction. But as I indicated already, that would not be something unusual in Eastern Europe, and in the whole of Europe would in fact follow the development in many other countries. There are a lot more things to say about individuals and about various episodes in the development of these three parties, but maybe I'll leave it at that and switch to the questions.
Let's begin our conversation before eventually we will move to the floor, which keeps expanding since the beginning of your talk. The first question would be, what is the far right? Let me just preface it by saying, I mean, there were elections in Italy just the other day. We've observed elections in France and Germany earlier in the year. We know what's happening in Russia, in Greece, in Hungary. When we say far right, there's always the issue of immigration. It seems to be the central issue. The far right parties are, at the very least, verbally very aggressive towards migrants and sometimes physically aggressive. There's street violence. Whereas in Ukraine, and that's true in Russia as well, immigrants, either it's migrants from Caucasus, Central Asia, or international migrants. In Ukraine, there are immigrants, obviously, but far less than, let's say, than in Western Europe or in Russia. And yet we call them far right. I mean, that's the theme of the talk, and it's in the literature. So what is it about these groupings that make them distinct, let's say, from the right? Or the populist right, that's another word that's being used.
Yeah, that I think is an issue that is in Ukraine more complicated than in other countries, because we have here this sort of mixture of liberationist nationalism and an exclusive nationalism. And if you look at the history of these three parties, the main three groupings, the Svoboda Party, the Right Sector, and Azov, and its predecessor organizations, then there is this ambivalence in these in the history that these were Patriot of Ukraine, the predecessor organization of the Azov Regiment and of the National Corps, or the Svoboda Party. They had periods when they were really very much focused on the issue of immigration. Anti-Semitism has been a topic. But in recent years, with the war in Eastern Ukraine and the new confrontation with Russia, the topics have shifted very much, and there was this there's an especially strange development in the with Azov, that there's a number of quotes that that are from Andriy Beletsky and from others from the time before they then became a relevant factor in Ukraine, where they speak about Aryanism, about the white race, and the special role that Ukraine would and Ukrainians would have to play in this. And later on, then Beletsky says that this is all not true. He has never said that, and that the that these are basically misquotes, and this is Russian propaganda. And I'm myself a little bit confused by that, because we have to go back and we have to find actually these texts to prove it. And if you don't have a video or an audio statement, it's difficult actually to prove that this was indeed published and written by, let's say, so this is a complicated issue, but in Ukraine, the way the question how to what kind of nationalism that is that these countries that these parties, I'm sorry, I'm still a little bit jet lagged, but sometimes I have these switching out, but. The topic of the war and the topic of national independence and of defense of the fatherland is so prevalent in these last 5-4 years that at least in my perception these other topics of xenophobia, ultranationalism, exclusiveness, nationalistic exclusiveness, and racism.
By that you mean Ukraine for Ukrainians?
Even that has become sort of been relativized. And of course, there is in the history also of Ukrainian nationalism. You can sort of pick out different quotes from the sort of the classics of Ukrainian nationalism, where you know some of these statements would be more exclusive, would be more anti-Semitic, would be more ultra-nationalist. But there would be other quotes. Even of Stepan Bandera, where there would be then a sort of a more inclusive nationalism, where the argument would be that that everybody who supports Ukrainian independence would be sort of included in the movement, and that has been clearly the trend for the last 4 years, and the right sector has had no problems to closely cooperate with Muslim Crimean Tatars, for instance, which would be something very difficult to imagine in
anywhere else in Europe.
There are also some exceptions, but that is in general that is not exactly the behavior. Or these far right activists, they would support Mikhail Saakashvili and so on. So these things do not really play a role. The classical issue.
You mentioned Bandera a few times in the talk, but it's like a very small group named something like Prizubininis de Bandera. That one was one of the constituents part of the private sector. And now, Stepan Bandera was the leader of the insurgency in World War II, the organization Ukrainian Nationalists. Now, we see the symbolism of Bandera. We saw it on Maidan, we've seen the portraits and so forth. My question is not what you think of Bandera as a scholar, it's a completely separate question, a complex one, but how do they relate? I mean, what is the symbolism of Bandera for these far-right groups? What does it mean to them right now in 2018 in the context of the war and so forth? What do they take from it?
Well, that's very difficult to say, again, because there are various ways to relate to this historical figure and to the organization of Ukrainian nationalists and the especially the Ukrainian insurgent army, and for some it is of course a fighter for liberation, for national independence. For others it is indeed a more nationalist symbol, and there's not just the idea of an independent Ukraine, but also of a particular type of Ukraine, or with a nationalist agenda. So, for instance, the right sector is clearly in this tradition, perhaps to the largest degree, and the right sector rejects liberal democracy quite explicitly. So, more explicitly than Svoboda, for instance. For Azov, I think for the national core, Bandera does not play such a role, or it does play a role, but it's seen as a more problematic issue. This particular legacy of Ukrainian nationalism, because the national core and Svoboda, they have this idea, and that makes them quite peculiar within this Ukrainian nationalist scheme, that they imagine they have a geopolitical scheme that they call Intermarium, that is a reference to the
You're referring to Azov.
To the geopolitical conception of Azov, which is by itself, that Azov has such a conception, is quite extraordinary. The right sector and Svoboda are much less articulate on foreign policy issues. And the idea of Azov and of the national core is that there should emerge in Eastern Europe a sort of a separate civilization called Intermarium, land between the seas, between the Baltic and the Black Sea, and that this new civilization that they have in mind would include Poland, and they fully understand that if Poland would be part of this, Belarus and the three Baltic republics as well, then the legacy of Bandera and of the is a problem, and that's why they have this they have a more distance approach to that. I would almost say that you have to actually take you would have to ask every individual of these far right activists what exactly Bandera means for them, because the reference could be very different things. It could be, there could be some people who see it more, who see the more sort of what has been called the sort of darker side of this movement, whereas for other of the history of this movement that would refer to episodes of collaboration of this movement, that would refer to anti-Semitism and to the sort of quasi-totalitarian state that in some of these documents of the UN was proposed, and for others it would be a symbol of liberation and of an independence fighter. For most actually Ukrainians, it would not refer to this to this more radical legacy of the movement. So this is also something that is sort of confusing, that Bandera is actually a figure that, of course, the attractiveness of which goes far beyond the far right, that includes, you could argue now, the National Democratic Center, and that has become in a way an official policy of the Ukrainian state, as expressed by the memory policies of the Ukrainian Institute for National Memory.
Well, let's add to the confusion something that wasn't expected, certainly to me, but I would gather for most of us. Svoboda, of course, was rooted in Western Ukraine, and I would love to see when I was Svoboda, actually, not Svoboda. So Svoboda itself, I mean, they did got 35% of the vote in 2012, you got that in the presentation. And they were major player, maybe they were kind of superseded by private sector on Maidan, central Maidan in Kiev, but in central and western Ukraine, they were the major players getting the, seizing the buildings and so forth. So good enough. But the new players, so to speak, that you mentioned in your talk, private sector, and then the battalions, Azov now emerged as the main one, but there were a number of others, like Aida and so forth, actually come from eastern Ukraine, or to a large part from eastern Ukraine. And we have this narrative that has always been around, but it's getting perhaps stronger, that language becoming a security issue in Ukraine, that is the Russian language. And so there's this kind of hardline narrative emerging. And yet we have the reality of battalions and parties, even though electorally not very, very strong at the moment, but still socially potent, functioning to some extent and sometimes to a large extent in Russia. Russian-speaking, far-right nationalist parties. That's not quite obvious at the same time that you have this narrative that Russian is a security issue. So how do you, as a scholar of the far-right, wrap your head around this phenomenon of the rise of the far-right in Russian-speaking Ukraine?
Well, I mean, we are talking here about parties that have...
I mean, by the rise of the far-right, but the fact that this movement, I'm not saying that the that most of Eastern Ukraine is turning into supporting the far right, but they emerged to a significant degree.
Yeah, I mean the most they get, all three of them get most of their electoral support in Western Ukraine still. Although indeed Azov comes mainly out of Kharkiv and
but the manpower
and the rights of Dnipropetrovsk or Dnipropetrovsk Oblast and the press secretary. Of the right sector, who calls himself Skoropadsky. His real name is Ichkov. He comes from Sevastopol. He speaks Russian. So this is indeed something quite extraordinary. And also, I think one of these factors that may actually prevent closer collaboration of these three parties in the future, because for Svoboda the language issue is very, very important, whereas for the right sector and for the national core it's a more ambivalent issue, because they indeed have many Russian speakers in their ranks. Yeah, this is a I think that is basically a result of the war, that the war has led to a general realignment, I would say, in Ukrainian politics, and to redefinition as well of national identity and of many issues. I think at the end of the day, I think the Ukrainian language is for all of them important, and I've spoken to some of these members of the Azov movement and of the right sector who are Russian speaking, who come from the Russian speaking part of Ukraine, and they would say, yes, we have to learn, and we are working on ourselves, and so I think what they basically see that indeed for a Ukrainian nationalist to be a Ukrainian nationalist, they will have to have a national language. And they will have to speak themselves properly Ukrainian. But indeed, that is quite something to then, especially on the background of this Kremlin propaganda, which of course talks a lot about. I mean, you could argue in a way even that in a very strange way the whole civil war. This idea is in a strange way maybe true, in that in Eastern Ukraine Russian speakers often fight against Russian speakers, so it's in a way a Russian civil war on Ukrainian territory.
Russian speaking.
And even ethnic Russians on the Ukrainian side fighting for Ukraine, and even citizens of some citizens of the Russian Federation. Actually, on the Ukrainian side, but also ethnic Russians in these battalions, especially fighting for Ukraine.
Now, Andreas, you've emphasized a great deal that since 2014, not between 2012 and 2014, when Svoboda got 35% Galicia, 12% nationally, and suddenly, wow, we've got a far right party, but with a very unusual constituency, as you pointed out. Work. But since 2014, with the elections and with a marginal support, both at the presidential and parliamentary level, which is certainly significant in when you compare it to other countries in Central Europe, Hungary, and in Greece, where you have a straight out neo-Nazi party with Golden Dawn, with 8% of the vote and in parliament, and so forth. But couldn't we say that outside of the electoral game, but they're still represented in parliament, from, however marginally in numbers, that these far-right groups or parties are kind of playing a disproportionate role, the same way that they did in a different context on Maidan itself. One argument could be this kind of the intimidation factor, that even if parliament, there's not that many of them, but they show up, you know, in military uniform khakis, and they, or if you have Azov parading, as we saw a few weeks ago downtown Kiev, it's, you know, it's striking. And it can't be dismissed as, well, they're not in parliament, so it doesn't count, it's just a show. And we know, not just during Maidan, but since, that they certainly have the capacity to engage in street protest, street demonstrations, or in the case of the complete blockade of transportation to occupy Donbass, force the hand, referring to what happened a year ago, force the hand of the government to switch its policies, because there's no way that they could control what's happening on the ground. So politically, even though, again, in terms of representation in parliament, it's marginal, they pull above their weight. Isn't that a fair argument to make?
Yes, but the ascription of these activities and of the motivations of these people who are involved in these actions, and even I would argue to, you know, if you look at the battalions, so, you know, the Dobrovolchi Ukrainsky Corps and so on. I'm looking forward to sociological surveys that will actually ask the soldiers of Azov and of these other nationalist or created by ultra-nationalist organizations, what is actually their worldview and what is actually behind their entry into an obviously nationalist battalion, and the same goes for these actions, for these domestic actions, that the line to draw between activists that may be driven by xenophobia and ultranationalism and anti-Semitism and so on, and activists that would go together with them, and that would be driven by totally different, by what I would call militant patriotism, is very, very difficult to draw this line. And I think there is, at least in my perception, there is an understanding that these battalions, most of them are now integrated mainly into the forces of the Ministry of Interior, to a smaller degree in the Ministry of Defense, that they cannot use their weapons in domestic affairs. And I think there's a, as I would see it, and maybe others have a different perception, a tacit agreement in society that, yes, I mean, on the front line, you know, they should have weapons and they are heroes, but this cannot be used. And when this then happened in August 2015, when there was this unfortunate demonstration in front of the Verkhovna Rada in connection with the attempted constitutional change, constitutional reform that was related to decentralization, but was then, I think, rather unfortunately linked to this special clause connected to the Minsk agreements, where the special status for the currently occupied territories would be then put into the constitution. There was then a protest against that, and it was led by Svoboda, and then one of the fighters of a volunteer battalion, Sich, that was linked to Svoboda, then threw a grenade, and there were then four people killed and dozens in late August 2015. Yeah, then I think that was an exception. There was an outcry then, and that was really something that I think, and that also signaled, I think, to Svoboda and to the other nationalists that the use of weapons within the political within Ukraine and within the politics is more permissible. And the national militias, the Nationale Druzhiny that Azov has now formed, so far they don't have weapons. They are unarmed militias. But there is a deep pressure that comes from these. But even there, I mean, you have these people in front of the Verkhovna Rada, led by Semyon Semenchenko. So and there were, there were portraits of Bandera and the
UPA flag. You're referring to the leader of one of the battalions.
I'm not sure. I've met Semenchenko. I'm not sure he is an ultra-nationalist. Donetsk Oblast and so on, and they use the symbols of the organization of Ukrainian nationalists, but they are militant and they are radical in the methods they're using, and they want a revolution. But I'm not sure that is really a fascist revolution or an ultra-nationalist revolution that they have in mind. I struggle with that because it's very confusing. You have, of course, you have quotes and certain types that are clearly on this sort of ethnocentric trip, but they mingle and they go together with others that are clearly driven by other motives. It's very difficult in this war situation. Maybe that's also something natural to appear. But it's clearly a very different situation. The sort of to distinguish this militant patriotism from ultra-nationalism is in Ukraine much more difficult than in Western countries, where the front lines, sort of the political front lines, are much clearer because there is no military front line, which redefines the entire.
One last question before we open it up. You studied, as I said, introducing you the Russian far right, the Russian fascist movement, well before, we're talking in the 90s when you were a graduate student. Now, the question is, to what extent the Russian far right and the Ukrainian far right, to what extent are they similar or different? I mean, the obvious difference is that there is a war, and of course, the far right is on the Ukrainian side, the Russian far right tends to be on the other side, but strangely enough, there are exceptions. Other than the fact that there is a war, and obviously that's two very, radically opposed conceptions of the role, the place of Ukraine in geopolitically. In terms of organization, in terms of ideas, since you've studied so much the Russian far right, how different or similar are they?
There are clearly some connections. There was a very violent Russian organization called Боевая организация русских националистов, which has links to Azov, and there have been some incidents where these Russian neo-Nazis that then have then appeared even on the front line on the Ukrainian side, mostly then in the so-called Russian core of Azov. But in general, I would make a large distinction because the Russian extreme right is almost entirely very imperialistic. It's a very extroverted imperialistic expansionist nationalism, whereas the Ukrainian nationalism tends to be more, introverted, if you want to put it that way.
Not obviously in terms of the goals, it's a complete clash. I mean in terms of mode of organization. to what extent you have similarities, mm-hmm. or it's really different types of phenomena.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of organization, I mean, you clearly have also a leadership principle in Ukrainian far right. You know, that you have the sort of charismatic figures, as you would usually expect in these kind of groupings. Maybe organizationally, purely on a, if you look at it on a very abstract level, there isn't that much difference. I think the main sort of contextual difference here is that these far-right groups in Russia, they operate in a closed political system where they have to decide whether they want to be part of the Putin system or they don't want to be part of that. Sometimes they switch also from the sort of systemic right and the non-systemic right. In Ukraine, there's no such thing. There's no
by sense. Systemic right, you mean tolerated and approved by the state?
Yes. Yeah. So this is a very different context. In Russia, I mean, there would be a good argument to say that the whole regime is already radical right. You know, that it's very traditionalistic, clericalistic, it's conspirological, Manichaean, and so on. So the regime, and some have argued even have called this regime already fascist, which I don't think is the right word, because fascism is about something more radical, and is about it's a revolutionary movement, whereas I wouldn't call Putin a revolutionary. But clearly there are many signs there that the regime is at least partly radical right. I think in Ukraine this is far less the case. So the context is very very different. I mean the organizations are perhaps in their structure not that different, but they are very leader oriented.
All right, so well, I'm sure there's plenty of questions. Let's start, let's start with Mr. Ambassador here. You'll set the tone.
Thank you, Dominique. I'm very first, welcome both of you. Thanks for coming and tackling this very sensitive issue in such an intellectual and comprehensive way. If I may, I would like to ask you to elaborate a little bit on Ukrainian far right and propaganda. You mentioned
more a general question of the role of the far right in violence in the early part of Maidan, in January, and then in February on the square. How does that square with what you presented?
Yeah, I would certainly say that that the right sector was very much present in all of the violent phases of the Euromaidan. But what I would also say is that this violence was not limited to the right sector, and that still the right sector was a very small part of the whole. So there was the after Maidan, and there were these reports from journalists where sort of where they. Housewives were making Molotov cocktails, yeah, and certainly the right sector was more violence prone perhaps than others, but that's why I wouldn't see if you would have a sort of a counterfactual in Euromaidan without the right sector, I'm not sure it would have been very different, because there were lots of people who at a certain point were ready to use violence. There was an escalation, and obviously the people of the far right, they would be more prone to, but because of their relatively low presence, they had hundreds of thousands, and then you had these 300 right sector people, and to ascribe to them a major role, I don't see any evidence for this. I would make a difference between the sniper massacre and the Odessa events because I think the question of who the snipers were and what this whole story is about is open. That I would admit, and maybe the story that you have told is maybe it's true, but still I would very much make a difference to the Odessa events, which were a spontaneous You know, the first people were killed in the city center, the first person in the city center, and that was not something that was organized by anybody. And even so, if you assume that there was a sort of conspiracy with the Snipers massacre, I would still wonder whether this is something that has really to do something with far-right extremism. Maybe people were used, or maybe there is a connection, and it is indeed, it is strange that there may have been people who went in advance away from who knew about this, but still I wonder how much this is a far-right phenomenon. Maybe there was a conspiracy. But I'm not sure that was something where I would say, you know, this was a sort of a far-right coup, and that Dmytro Jarosz was the main person in all of that. Maybe he was used. Maybe if there was indeed, you know, this is all an if, because we don't know who exactly were whoever is the snipers. And
the question on
obviously these people were present, but I've been in Kiev and I don't, you know, And I saw these people, and they were very active. They were hyperactive. That is what was then reflected often in the press. That is Ishenko's approach, who then counts the press reports about the far right. Still, it wasn't a far right revolution. It was not a. These people were hyper. If you came to the Euromaidan, the Svoboda flags the symbols of the right sector were very much present, but this was a relatively small circle of people who were hyperactive. But it wasn't a far-right revolution. So this is a, you know, and also in comparative terms, I mean, if you knew what was there before, if you know what was in Ukraine, if you know what is happening in other countries, it's I don't see it. Enough evidence to say that this is really something that plays a big role in, and the integration of these battalions created partly by far right organizations. Well, that was something that what would you have done? You know, they you know, what was the solution for this problem? That was a war situation, an existential situation.
That's exactly what was done in Georgia after the Civil War. Yeah. They integrated battalions into regular forces.
I think these battalions have received an extraordinary amount of attention, Azov and the Duke and so on. But you know, I've sort of calculated that probably that was not more than 10% of the whole of the troops at the Azov. That were in battalions created by national ultra-national organizations.
All right, Michael.
Okay. Let's get what your impression on an encounter I had with somebody from Right Sector. I was an election observer, and he was telling me as an observer, you know, hey, you know, we're not really right-wing people. We're actually a group of people that sat in the right side of the football stadium. And we're kind of nationalistic people, and we've been labeled as sort of right wing. So I just want your impression on that statement he made to me. So.
Yeah, I mean, there are several stories about this. That there's also a story that, you know, there was some meeting on Maidan, and then somebody said, you know, these people should take care of the right sector, and that's how the name runs. But if you look at these at the organizations, they were. Behind the creation of the right sector, I mean, these were clearly, you know, radically nationalist organizations, largely, and also today. I mean, if you look at their program, they clearly reject liberalism, they reject democracy, they want a revolution, they don't accept the liberal constitutional state. But still, I would admit there might have been still people with a relatively liberal worldview who would go to them because these were the tough guys, you know, or they would go to this Dobrovolchi Ukrainsky Korpus not because they they are against liberalism and against constitutional democracy, but because they want to go to the toughest unit. That might have been, but this is clearly an organization that is driven by nationalist authoritarian views. Although I would admit, you know, this is, if they then have a press secretary who is with a Jewish background, and they would cooperate closely with Muslim Crimean Tatars, that is not a typical behavior usually for a far right.
Gordana?
I have a question. You suggested that it's more difficult to compare far right in Ukraine with far right in Western Europe, just because there's no war in Western Europe and there's no war in Ukraine. Would you think that it's perhaps more appropriate to compare those far right political parties and their farm organizations in Ukraine with similar organizations and political parties that existed during the Yugoslav wars, in Croatia, Bosnia, Kosovo, because maybe it would be more useful to compare those two different contexts rather than Ukraine.
Are you familiar with such others?
Yeah. I mean, there's a theory around, a whole theory around that with regard to the UN, to the Bandera movement. Where Ukrainian scholar says that there should be a special sort of category for these ultra-nationalist organizations that appeared in states that had no national independence, and then he introduces the term Ustashism. Alexander Zaitsev makes this. He says, you know, UNBE was a very radically nationalist organization, but it has to be distinguished from fascism because it emerged in a country that had no state. Yet. So, I know of this comparison. I don't know the Balkan far right.
Well, during the World War II, I meant actually political parties that organized during the World War military groups that fought in Bosnia and Croatia.
Yeah, I don't know them. I don't know these Balkan groups well enough to.
I would suggest it would be more useful to compare those.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe you're right. Yeah.
Especially since there's historical antecedents in the literature. So yeah. This argument that there's a comparison between the UN and the Ustashi, and who expand us and carry them over.
Yeah. But in a way, you could also turn it the other way around. The Serbian Radical Party, which was very sort of close to these armed groups on the Serbian side, was in elections hugely successful. You know, they had up to 50% in elections.
The
Serbian Radical, yeah. And that is something that
they were not the only one.
Yes.
And they were in opposition to Milosevic's party.
But still.
But they were not the only ones.
Yes, yes.
There were, in fact, political parties that were openly pro-Western and pro-democratic.
Okay.
And that organized paramilitary organizations that fought in Bosnia and committed war crimes.
Committed war crimes, though.
Yeah. Okay. Most of them actually committed war crimes.
Yeah, I mean most of the volunteer battalions in Ukraine, they had no particular or prolific ideological background. They would be sort of patriotic. Some of them were created, and you know, and then these would be. But in a way, I mean, I mentioned this Serbian Radical Party, which was in elections hugely successful. Because that is something that you would sort of expect also, but it didn't happen in Ukraine. That makes it very sort of then also uncomparable, because this radical nationalism in a war situation has not translated, oddly, I would say, in Ukraine into support. Although these people are very well known, they are very prolific, they have a very sort of accepted military record. But maybe that's not what you meant, actually. But that's the only party that now actually comes to my mind. I haven't studied before.
Excuse me. There's a difference between the Azov and, like, it's when you cross the line of committing hate crimes. See, in Hungary, they had the Jobbik, that some of them went and burned the homes of gypsies. And for a long time, the government wasn't doing anything until the people took to the streets to demand their arrest. And when you have a society of conscience, then parties like the Azov and the far right will never get anywhere, because what they're dreaming of having, this territory with the Baltics and Poland and all this, is never going to happen, because the Baltics will oppose it. The people of conscience of these countries will oppose it, because otherwise it would take a war, and it won't get there. So I don't think that Ukraine has anything really to worry about these parties. The problem is that they really have to keep an eye on is when they cross that line into hate crimes and nothing is done about it.
Okay.
The state has to ensure they do something.
Thank you. We'll take a last question.
Thank you much for this beautiful endeavor. A very short question. Is there any difference in terms of the sympathy, if there is a sympathy toward the far right parties among the generations of Ukrainians, so let's say people who are 20, 30, 40? Do you have any numbers?
I don't know. I haven't looked this particular issue up, but I can't remember any particular correlation there. I think the only thing that I now remember, that in general these parties have slightly more support invested. That's the only thing that now comes to my mind, where you can actually sort of describe certain demographics, describe certain demographics.
All right, been at it for 2 hours. It was quite a session. Is Michael McKee here?
I don't know. Is Michael McKay here?
McKay?
No, it's not.
Okay, so we'll ask Michael Kostyuk to say a few words on behalf of UCPBA.
Okay, I wasn't prepared for this, but okay.
It's tradition.
On behalf of Michael McKay, who I thought was going to be here, he's not here, I'd like to thank our two speakers here, actually, and I think they did a wonderful job, and I think they actually... There was a little bit of actually apprehension coming up to this talk. I don't know if you're aware of that, but I think, and all of you who have attended, I don't think there was any problem with the speech, and I thought we all learned a bit, right? Mm-hmm. So we all give them a round of applause.
Well, thank you to Andreas, to the UCPBA for their support, for the Center for Okay, because actually the next event will be, where's Miron? We need Miron. Come in. Miron Mamrik wrote a book, and that's going to be our next event on Miron. Come back.
Oh, yeah.
There he is. He's coming.
You can do it.
On March 28th, he's coming back. Just hold on. Okay, Miron. Poor timing.
What can I do now?
So the next event of the chair will be a book presentation of the latest opus by Miron Mamrik, who wrote the biography of the first Canadian Ukrainian who became a minister of the federal government, Mike Starr.
Mike Starr, Starchevsky.
Starchevsky, Mikhailo Starchevsky.
The first Ukrainian Canadian minister who was not French, not English, in the deep Vapor government. And we set the trend of having French non-English representative in cabinet to the point where today we have four Sikhs in the government.
Four Sikhs, and we of course have a Canadian-Ukrainian foreign minister, very well known. So in 3 weeks, exactly on the 28th of March, we'll have an event around the book by Miron Mamrik. Thank you to all, hope to see you on the 28th.
Has not followed the case of Russia and other countries where the influence of far right is much higher. I think many of us still have this question, why it's not the case. Okay. So do we see any specific differences in terms of the Ukrainian society that does not provide more ground for far right in Ukrainian politics? And one tiny comment on something that Dominic mentioned, and it's about the way the Ukrainian parliament is dressed up. about clothes and uniforms in the Ukrainian government. So actually, I think there are maybe 7 or 8 people who do wear uniforms in the Ukrainian government. But if you look at the Ukrainian MPs, you will see much more t-shirts, jeans, and polos. And there is explanation for that, because 67% of MPs, they are elected for the first time. I think it's a very special time for Ukraine. I think most of them would like to show that they're different from the previous political establishment. And out of those 7 or 8 people who wear uniforms, aside of Bielecki, all the others they represent, Narodny Front, some of Pomich, some mainstream parties, so their uniforms have nothing to do with their political choice. They became members of parliament right from the front line, and I think that's just a way to show their solidarity with the Ukrainian military who will fight the war to defend our country.
All right, thanks for the silent statement. Andreas, there's 2 questions. The first on information warfare.
Дякую, велика честь. I mean, I started with that. You came, I think, a little bit late, so that was my entry as well. I think the problem that I see here is that, of course, you have these groups in Ukraine, and they are using Azov still uses the so-called Black Sun. They have a symbol which reminds of the so-called Wolf's Crook. Wolfsanger, which has been used by the SS, and they have these symbols, and you can, of course, you can produce pictures of people who have swastikas and all sorts of symbols that can be associated with the far right, and then these pictures can be sort of multiplied. They can be shown many times, and I think the strategy to deal with this is to say, yes, of course, we have that. You know, this is. But that is also the case in other countries. You know, in Germany, for instance, I'm always telling people, Ukraine never had something like what was called the National Socialist Underground, the NSU, Nationalsozialistischer Untergrund, which was a small neo-Nazi cell that over the course of several years was secret, was not detected, and they managed to kill about I can't remember the I think it was about 10 Turks over several years, and they were not detected
in Germany.
And there was never anything like that in Ukraine. I mean, of course, far right activists then probably killed other people, but that was in the context of war. That is something that has to be distinguished from this underground, and so I think the reaction that I often see is that this is all lie and that doesn't exist and so on and so on. But I think the strategy to react is to say yes, it does exist, but it is not something another argument, for instance, that goes well in or that is usually. Then sort of in the German context, at least, very, very important is to say that the prime minister of Ukraine is an ethnic Jew. And then this whole idea of a fascist coup can be also devalued. I think there's also to be acknowledged that some of the politicians that now belong to the National Democratic camp, they come out of organizations that were far right. Andriy Parubiy was in the 1990s linked to the Social National Party of Ukraine, but then Troyan comes out of the Azov movement. So that is also something not unusual. You know, they are also in investment politics, politicians that have sort of histories, biographies in extreme. On the left side, yes. About the weakness of the far right, that is indeed still unresolved issue for me. I mean, the one obvious thing is that there was also, at least until the war, another sort of type of nationalism that sort of pan-Slavic, pro-Russian, Eurasian nationalism, but it was sort of competing. You could argue that the in spite of its name, so-called Progressive Socialist Party of Ukraine, of Natalia Petrenko, sort of represented this other type of sort of anti-Western nationalism for a while, and people like Taras Kuzio even thinks that the Party of Regions was sort of in a way this far-right organization, which I don't think is the right word for this particular phenomenon. But that has now changed. I think this division of this sort of in the reference in the nation to, or the concept of the nation to which these extremists would refer has changed. The political nation of Ukraine is now largely unified, as I would see it. And still, it's relatively weak, and I think it remains an open question. I think part of the explanation is that there are just that the typical issues that far-right parties use are not salient in Ukraine. There are simply other issues. It's mainly about independence, about European integration. I mean, one of the odd things, if you come from a sort of Western from the Western studies of far-right parties, is that the entire faction of the Svoboda Party in the parliament of Ukraine voted when the association agreement with the European Union was ratified, voted for the ratification. That is very unusual. You know, usually these parties or the parties actually with which Svoboda used to cooperate, they were part of a trans-European or an all-European alliance of nationalist movements, and these parties would be very much against the European Union. But that is, but the fact that Svoboda then voted for the association agreement has to do with the fact that simply other issues are more and more salient. And as Dominique mentioned, the immigration issue is not much of an issue. And even then, if I imagine that there's now a huge demographic problem in Ukraine, and also the problem of immigration from Ukraine. If there comes at some point that we all hope for that the economy will pick up, I could very well imagine that there could be a large stream of immigrants from not only from the post-Soviet area that would come into Ukraine. And I wonder how much this will actually then feed sort of more ethnocentrism. We had a few indications already when there were Syrian refugees coming to Ukraine. There was some reaction then from groups like Azov to it. But even then, I would think that even larger immigration may not actually create may not actually lead to a large. All right.
We'll take, yes.